then the material property and the dimension. So when these three ingredients are there, that becomes a design equation, which is applicable here. So in this case, there is a torque, there is a polar moment of inertia of this cross section, which is the geometry, and then G is material property, modulus of rigidity, theta in our case is going to be this theta, and L in our case is the total length. So keeping this in mind, and keeping whatever is discussed here, let us go further and find out the equation for relating the deflection with the other parameters. So I'll write now this formula further and we will go ahead. Before that, we came across, see, this is one thing we have seen, then we also saw that deflection delta is theta into d by 2. And the third thing is, we saw that T upon J equal to G theta upon L. Therefore, right here, therefore theta is equal to T into L upon J and G. So now I'll write this again. Now what is T? T is equal to W into D by 2. What is L? L is pi dN. What is J? J for this cross section is pi d raised to 4 upon 32. And then there is a G. And at the same time, theta is given by this equation. Theta is, theta into d by 2 is delta. So now what I do is, we'll write delta is equal to theta into d by 2. Therefore, it is equal to this whole thing into d by 2. So I'll write maybe here that delta is equal to w d upon 2 into pi d n upon pi d raised to 4 upon 32 into g, and this d by d into 2 is also there, so into d upon 2. So delta is all this. Now when this is rearranged, I'll write directly what happens after it is rearranged. After rearranging the terms of this equation, it gives delta is equal to 8 W d cube n upon g d raised to 4. Or, in other words, 8 W c cube n upon g d. Because d upon d is c, so 3 d's are taken with these 3 d's. So that becomes C cube and 1D remains, which is here. So that this is the equation for deflection with the other parameters. So the deflection is related to all the other parameters consisting of load, consisting of wire diameter, consisting of material property, consisting of coil diameter, and consisting of number of turns. All these things are together related to each other by this formula. So this becomes one more design equation which is used while designing this particular type of a spring. So when we are designing a spring, we are using the earlier equation, that was a stress equation which was derived earlier. Shear stress equal to wall stress factor, and then 8 W d cube upon pi d raised to pi d cube. 8 W d cube, not the cube is not there, 8 W d upon pi d cube into k. So this becomes another equation. So with these equations, we are in a position, this and this, we are in a position to design the spring. Now in addition to that, there are some other equations are also there. So what I'll do is, I'll just write all the equations at one place. equation used for design of an elegant spring of circular cross section. So we already seen earlier n dash is equal to n plus 2, one equation. Then we also saw free length is equal to delta max plus delta max plus solid length n dash d plus say 0.15 times d. Now last time I had taken this whole thing as 2, but it can be 15% of the wire diameter, something like that. Then the next is shear stress factor 1 plus 1 upon c, wall stress factor 4c minus 1 upon 4c minus 4 plus 0.615 upon c. Then shear stress is k or ks, then it is 8 wd upon pi cubed. Then there is deflection formula, which is delta is equal to 8 w d cube l upon gd raised to 4. And then pitch is equal to free length upon n dash minus 1. So these are some of the different equations which are used for the purpose of designing a spring of this type, which is a helical spring with a circular cross section. So when a load W is applied, the spring of coil diameter D, internal diameter DI, external diameter DO, wire diameter D and free length LF will be giving you a deflection delta by relating all these parameters by this equation, and it will have induced stress in the wire given by shear stress equal to these terms. So this way we are going to design a particular spring when the delta is given. Now we will take some example later on where we will be able to understand how the design is carried out. Now there are some other things, small things which are remaining. This particular spring, the end connection, now see the way the last coil is made here compared to the rest of the coils, these last two coils are not taking part in the deflection. But then they need to be prepared in a particular manner so that the entire spring will be able to get fitted in the required assembly. So that is called as how the ends of the springs, they are to be modified. So we'll take up that topic later on to find out how to modify the ends of the springs. Up till now we have discussed the basic nomenclature and the various formulae that are there which are used for the purpose of designing a spring. Thank you very much. We'll see the next part in the next video lecture. Okay, now let us see the next part here. End connections of a compression spring. Now suppose the spring is just like this. Now this kind of spring, it is there, there is a raw spring, you can say. There is no modification carried out to the ends. So if that is the case, then as you can see here, this becomes very difficult to assemble because the axis of the spring is like this and the ends are inclined. So it is not possible to fit such springs in the machines. That means the ends are to be modified. That is what we are now going to see here. So this first example is actually not useful, but this is what is called as a spring which has got a plane ends. First type is plane. The ends are plane ends. The second type is when the ends are modified. Now what they do is they are going to ground this end. So if I grind this like this, then this becomes the shape of a wire. So I draw it like this. The end is ground, and then this is the rest of the shape. And so on. So the last, again you will see that it's ground like this. Something like this. It will come in fact exactly at the middle. So the wire diameter is ground here. Sometimes shown like this. This is grounded. So by grinding action, the spring is, you can say, literally cut here. So that the end becomes flat and this flat end becomes perpendicular to the axis. This is 90 degrees. So this is achieved by grinding action. This is a plane end, ground end. Then the next is, I'll show you here, third one. Now here what is done is, this end is squared. The name is squared. Squared end. So here what is done is, this last end which is there, it is just turned. So the way it was drawn earlier, at the start, if you remember how we are drawn, it was drawn like this. And then the last ones like this. This is the axis. Now here nothing is ground, no cutout. The last coil is bent so that it becomes horizontal. Both the last coils, they were initially inclined like this. So they are turned and they are made straight. Like this, so that they become horizontal, and then this is called a squared end. The ends are squared, so plane, then ground by machining, and then squared, and the fourth is a combination of these two. That means squared and ground. Squared and ground. That means it is done like this, and plus it is ground. So the figure comes something like this. Because of the grinding, the diameter becomes half. And then the rest of the shape continues like this. And again here, there is a half shape. Something like this. So this is the end, which is ground also and squared also, so squared and ground. So these are the four different types of ends which you will find for a helical spring, helical compression spring. So plane end, ground end, squared and round end. So these are the four types. Now let us take one example. Design a spring for the following conditions. The conditions are, spring load when the valve is open, right here 400 newtons. Spring load when valve is closed, 150 newtons. DI is equal to 25 mm. Length of spring. When valve open. Length of the spring when the valve is open, 40 mm. Length of spring when the valve is closed, 50 mm. Shear stress. Design shear stress is given as 40 kilonewtons per head in a centimeter square. Spring index 6.6 and modulus of rigidity G is given as 84 into 10 raised to 3 newton per mm square. Then the figure is like this. So as you can see here, the data of the problem is given. This is the construction. So as you see here, right now the valve is closed. The spring is applying certain pressure, certain force it is applying on the lever. Now when the valve is open, that time when the valve is getting lifted up, the lever will be in this position and the spring will be further compressed. So that's why you can see here, the spring load when the valve is closed, that means right now the valve is closed, it is having a force of 400 newtons that is existing on the spring. Now length of the spring when the valve is closed, right now it is 50 mm. Now when you open the valve, that time the length will reduce because this is inclined. So length of the spring when the valve is opened is less, 40 mm. And at that time, the spring load, the force acting on the spring is going to be 400 newtons because it is pressed further down. So it will exert more force. Therefore, these are the readings for different the two positions, open and closed. In addition, certain other things are given. The inside diameter of the coil, let me this diameter from inside. This diameter is 25 mm. The spring index is given 6.6. Modulus of rigidity is 84 into 10 raised to 3. You have to see the units also. It is centimeter square. Now see how this is solved. Now I'll erase this data, this will be still there. First let us find out D, that is the wire diameter. Now we know that wire stress factor 4C minus 4, 4C minus 4 it is, 4C minus 1 upon 4C minus 4 plus 0.615C. So this value you will get. Now in this example, it is coming as 1.227. therefore shear stress is equal to K 8 WC upon pi D square. So in this equation, when you put all the given values, this gives us D as 0.41 or other 4.5 mm. Now D is coil diameter, that is BI plus D. So this value is available now because 25 is the capital D and plus 4.5. This is maybe 29.5. That is a coil diameter. Now in this case we are not going to do any rounding off because these properties will change if you round off these wire sizes, any size. So whatever sizes are there, they are kept as it is. Now to find the number of turns, Now we have found out the wire diameter. Now we are going to find out how many turns are required. Now see how that is done. There is an equation which says delta is equal to 8 W B cube L upon GD raised to 4. Now in this equation, if you put all the things that are available, then you can find N as, in this equation it comes as 14.3. This can be taken as 15, the immediate higher number we can take. Now as a result, the total number of turns, that is N plus 2, that is going to be 17. Now to find out the free length. Now for finding out the free length, we require, you can see the formula, it says LF is delta max plus solid length plus 0.15 times D. So now N dash D you can find out, solid length. This also you can find out, but what is the maximum deformation in this case, that we need to know. Now you can see right now the spring is deformed by some amount. It will be deformed further down also when the valve is open. So when that happens, that time that is going to be the total deformation. That means the spring is in reality it is going to be something here. So this is the free length of the spring going to be. Out of this free length, right now it is compressed. And after some time when the valve is open, that time it is going to be maximum compressed. Maybe something like this from here to here. This is going to be the delta max. So the spring is going to be compressed this much as its maximum deformation, which is going to be taken here. But then what is delta max, we should know. Now what is delta max? Delta max is the deformation that will take place when you are applying the maximum load here. Now in the earlier data it is written that the maximum load W max is given as 400 newtons. That means when the load is maximum 400 newtons, what is going to be the deformation? That is what we have to find out. Now how we find out that? We can find out that by making use of the given conditions. So if you see the given conditions, the conditions say that when the load is 400, the spring length is 440 mm. When the load is 150 newtons, the spring length is 50 mm. That means when the change in the load, in this case, the change in the load is 250. So when the change is, when the load is changed by 150 newtons, that time the deformation is 10 mm. So by this what we gather is, right here, newtons correspond to 10 mm. What we gather from this data is when the load is changed by 150 newtons, the deformation happens is 10 mm. So with this ratio you can find out when the load is 400 newtons, what is going to be the deformation. So 150 is 10, so 400 is how much? So delta max, delta max. So delta max is going by 400 into 10 divided by 150, whatever it comes, that is already available here. So for 150 mm it is 10, so for 400 mm it is going to be 26.7 delta max. So once you know delta max, now it is possible to find out free length. So free length is, you can find out delta max, I write this formula again, plus n del d plus 0.15 times d. So all these three figures you can get, and you can get the free length. Once you get the free length, then the pitch. Pitch is equal to free length upon n dash minus 1. Now why n dash minus 1? Because n dash, they are the total turns, and the space between the turns will be less by 1. So n dash minus 1, these are the number of spaces. So divide the total length by the spaces. Space means the clearance between the two coils. So this is one coil, the other coil. So the space here is going to be how many number of spaces are there? One space. So like that, number of spaces will be total number of coils, that is n dash minus 1. So this is the pitch. So by this you will see that we have found out everything. So the answer is that use a wire whose diameter is small d, and then the wire should have number of turns what is already calculated, at least 7 d. Pitch distance let it be this much, and the free length will be this much. So once you do that, then this will be the spring which will give you the requirements, whatever requirements are there, and they will be satisfied. That means such spring, when you are compressing by this much amount, it will give you this much amount of force and so on. So the properties will be available in the spring if it is designed like this, and these are the different dimensions of the spring. So this is how we have designed this particular spring. Now let's discuss one small topic, that is on one small topic is there, that is on springs in series and parallel. Springs in series and parallel. First let us take series. In series. Now what it means is, so there are two springs used, one spring here, another spring here. This spring has got stiffness K1, second spring has got stiffness K2, and these two springs, when they are connected in series like this, whatever they are doing, whatever is their property is same as a property of a single spring whose stiffness is K equivalent. So this